My white stick is back at the hotel. Inspirational is a funny word if you think about it, as to inspire is to motivate people to seek change. Across the world, motivational speakers stride platforms seeking to instill a message of change into people's behaviours, attitudes or beliefs. With the prospect of doing something different with your life, they proclaim how it's always possible to become something different. Sometimes you just need that opening, a crack in a doorway, calling you through the entryway to another place. In many ways, this was one of the purposes of our journey, to show how many things truly are possible. When we try to write about such things, people may think it pompous or self-important to talk of the journey in this way. But it's not who we are or what we think. You see, we know we're lucky. It's easy to say this when you understand that many times in life, an opportunity rests purely on a situation when all the planets line up. In our own case, it became possible to set off despite the hundreds of barriers sitting in our way. We set out wanting people to know there are possibilities if you believe and have the courage to step through the doorway. Sometimes it's the will to take action that people lack. After all, opportunities mean nothing without the courage to grab them. This view is confirmed as whispering tracers reach across to where we sit on the other side of the world, as we hear of an Australian talking to a fellow passenger on a train to Liverpool. Mike tells his fellow passenger how he was sitting in Australia reading about a blind woman going around the world on a motorcycle. The next day, he went to his bank, withdrew $3,000, bought a backpack and a plane ticket, while thinking, if a blind woman can do it. He used the word inspirational as the carriage rattled its way onwards, and he soon learnt he was sitting next to Bernard's dad. The world can be a very small place. Against this backdrop of stories reaching across the world, Panama is gripped in the paranoia of swine flu, sweeping the world as we land. Face masks issue muffled voices, like dentists trying to hold a conversation with a patient. Making our way through the airport, we present ourselves to the immigration department, where a voice asks, "How long do you stay in Panama?"
"About a week," comes Bernard's reply. "I will give you 3 months," the smiling immigration officer says. "You may like Panama for longer than 1 week."
The thump of the stamp signals our official entry in Central America. 28 minutes later, we walk into our hotel after a short bus ride, and on reaching our room, Bernard is asleep in seconds, while I listen to the final chapters of The Da Vinci Code by Dan Brown. I'm asleep soon afterwards. It's good to wake up on a new day, knowing there's no packing and repacking the bike. This can wait for another day or so. After leaving Tumbes in Peru and crossing Ecuador and Colombia in 6 days, it's a relief to lie still and listen to the hum of the air conditioning. The previous frantic days have taken their toll, and we're both tired from the continuous mountain passes and pockmarked roads with holes big enough to swallow Bertha. With a leisurely day ahead, we relax until Bernard can contain himself no longer, about 39 heartbeats after waking. Reaching for the phone, he discovers Bertha has arrived and can be picked up tomorrow. The next morning arrives, and despite 2 alarms being set, a brass band playing and World War III breaking out in the room next door, we oversleep. It's not that we're tired, you understand. It's worse than that. Much worse. Somebody has stolen our will. They snuck up during the night, making off with it as we find that lethargy is the new name for energy. While both words have somewhat similar ending, we're content to wallow in the former rather than the latter. Gradually rousing ourselves into action, we find our way to the cargo office where Carmen takes us under her wing. She's been telling everybody, when she stops laughing and smiling, of the imminent arrival of the blind Englishwoman on the big motorbike. Her English is excellent, and she loves our authentic voices, calling colleagues over so they too can come and listen to a real English accent. It's always hard to be sure what people make of our Lancashire, me, and vaguely Liverpool, Bernard's accents. But they seem to enjoy everything we say immensely, if they understand us at all. Waving cheerily to us, Carmen gives us instructions on where to go to get the various bits of paper stamped that she hands over in a thick sheaf. Walking back to the front gate in the tropical heat for stamp number one to be achieved, we practice our very finest English. The rain in Spain falls mainly on the British Isles, until it sounds somewhat convincing. On reaching the gate, an officer notices my blindness and issues orders in staccato, machine-gun-like Spanish, and seconds later we're bundled like sardines into a 4x4, with Bernard straddling the gear lever. Nervously twitching every time a gear change is required, he manfully refuses to admit it, but still cannot help emphasising his masculinity by sounding several octaves lower whenever he speaks. Arriving at the police hut, officers wear their shields on lanyards around their neck, like the best American exported movie characters. One tries to engage us in Spanish before shifting to halting English, which Bernard compliments while apologising in terrible Spangolese about his own poor Spanish. The officer is obviously pleased with the compliment, and he already knows of the arrival of the English moto. Even on arriving at the first gate on the way in, the guard had welcomed us with, "Ah, la moto inglese." Bertha's fame precedes us, as always. The two police officers come to a rapid realisation that my blindness involves a connection with my legs, as orders are shouted and another 4x4 is summoned to chauffeur us back to the cargo offices due to my sudden inability to walk. This time Bernard is not required to perform the splits across the centre console, and his voice remains normal. Carmen is stunned at our speedy return with everything signed, until Bernard explains the help of the lovely customs and police officers, before he finishes off with a rousing chorus of, "We love Panama." The office staff smile at his antics. Flatterer. People hold doors and step out of the way as we walk the short distance to the warehouse, and there she is. Bertha the boxer. Bertha the semi-invincible. Resplendent in Ecuadorian and Colombian dust and muck. Due to the mad exit from Colombia and our ineffectual agent, Franklin the probably wifeless, the battery wasn't even disconnected, nor the petrol completely drained. With a few swift pumps, the tyres inflate, and she fires up first time to exit the warehouse, where all work has stopped, as people appear from all over the compound to watch events. The Colombian drug search has left our gear all over the place, a bit like Bernard being let loose in a hotel room for several days. So most of it is bunged into a taxi, whose driver asks for $15 before one of the cargo managers pounces on him with rapid Spanish. "Pay him no more than $10. Even this is too much for the journey." It confirmed our view that the $15 to get here from the hotel was indeed excessive. However, it demonstrates one of the problems you'll always have travelling overland in this way. Whenever a new country appears on the horizon, it would be very helpful, at least for the locals, to reach into the left pannier and rummage around until you find the big rubber stamp marked "mug". Gripping it firmly in your hand, you then apply it to your forehead, as it avoids any confusion for the locals, who may not recognise the huge red motorcycle bearing gifts. Many times over our journey so far, we've talked about the hunt locals engage in as they run around searching the undergrowth for Rudolph, as obviously Santa has ridden into town. There's always an inevitable struggle to understand relative values for a few days, while the sound of silent sleigh bells echo all around us, until we catch up. Then we feel foolish when coming to understand how much things really are. It's a wonderful thing, hindsight, and it teaches us all. Thus, the early days always seem to involve being stung numerous times until we acclimatise. Arriving back at the hotel and parking Bertha in a disabled bay, she has the sticker. Everything changes, as no longer are we simply two anonymous guests. Suddenly, as always, we become something different, something exotic, something unique. The same attendants who had merely watched us come and go before now come over to talk to us. Bellboys who had simply smiled as we'd wandered through the hotel now stand looking at Bertha as our cloak of invisibility drops away with the bike. In and out of the hotel, we wander under this scrutiny all through the afternoon, with fluids being checked and bits of this and that tightened down. A massive crack in the windshield suffered during the recent shipment is glued together after Bernard convinces a very nervous hotel caretaker to drill two holes through the plastic, one at each end of the crack. This, he assures me, should stop the crack from continuing its inevitable route, like a snail's meandering trail. The drill is consigned back into the hotel, along with a 100-foot lead snaking from the reception desk, through the foyer, out the door, and across the road to Bertha. Meanwhile, Colombian, Ecuadorian, and Panamanian stickers find homes on the luggage boxes, while tyre pressures are checked with the afternoon disappearing before Bernard pronounces himself satisfied. All the time, people wander over to snap pictures as we work throughout the afternoon. Relaxing and washing clothes, we reflect on how different everything now feels compared to the night before, when nobody connected with us. At this instant, with Bertha outside, Americans approach us, saying, "Good to see you two people having a good time," while other sentences, other thoughts, often involve the word inspirational. Many times, they go on to tell us of their own motorcycles, sitting at home, how they would love to do such a journey. After such conversations, our own thoughts turn to the opening doorways of opportunity, how turning a dream into reality must still involve taking a final critical decision. It's at this point that dreams either change into something concrete, something tangible, or forever remain fleeting images in our heads of what might have been. At breakfast the next morning, hands are placed gently on my shoulder, and American accents wish me good morning as Bernard loads up a tray from the self-service array of offerings, while I sit, listening to the welcoming voices appearing. It's so nice, and the whole experience of Panama seems one of being very, very aware of visual impairment. Hours later, we wave to the assembled staff collected at the front door before pulling away to find our first petrol station in Panama. A gallon costs $2, or £1.30, and again it reminds us of the £1 per litre in England, where draconian taxes are levied, making UK petrol 400% dearer than anywhere else so far. Toll booths come and go as we wind our way across the long causeway, cutting across the muddy bay towards the city itself, revealing a land of skyscrapers. It's hot, sweaty stuff, and the road is missing huge drain covers, big enough to swallow the front wheel without even a burp. Cars dive left and right to miss the subterranean entrances to the Panamanian underworld. And we weave around in the same manner, involving frighteningly late changes of direction, as huge holes suddenly appear from underneath the car in front. Driving round and round, looking for the Pan American, we eventually blast across the Panama Canal itself, over a bridge full of huge signs declaring dire consequences if you stop to take photographs. The roads outside the city are good compared to our recent experiences in South America, and the suspension easily absorbs the rough surface. We make progress along the C1 as towns drift past, and the mileage clocks up towards the Costa Rica border, 560 kilometres away. Penonomé, 150 kilometres, changes to Santiago at 248 kilometres, before Tole appears at 348 kilometres. Our speed climbs, as good stretches allow Bertha to stretch her legs, as the landscape changes from flat fields full of cattle, horses and goats to jungle closing in on the single-lane road. Bertha's leg stretching rises to such a point that a very nice Panamanian police officer introduces himself, along with his very shiny new radar gun, on a particularly beautiful sweeping downhill left-hand corner. In the ensuing conversation, he maintains our speed was 120 kilometres per hour in a 100 zone. Bernard punches buttons on the dashboard and shows the recorded 107 top speed on the sat-nav system, which now works intermittently. The policeman laughs and agrees with the speed recorded on his own offending item before license and tickets are both discussed. Needless to say, there's no paperwork for the $20 fine, as a single crisp note is passed over for the return of the international driving license as he reinforces the speed limit. Helpfully, he then gives us the rundown on the road ahead, the speed traps, the drug enforcement agency roadblocks, bad bends, dangerous places, petrol stations, and where the Martians abduct locals along the route. In many ways, it's money well spent, as we find out there's no petrol for 100 kilometres after a town called David. Philosophically, it's now possible to accept that if people are not paid enough money, they will supplement their income somehow. We can imagine him talking to his wife that night. Yes, he was married with two children, as we found out. "I met an English couple today." "Did you, love?" she responds, preparing dinner. "Yes, she was blind, and they were on a big motorcycle. They were very happy people, and even thanked me after I fined them. Shook hands with them, and it was all laughing and joking. I do like the English. They're always so polite. By the way, here's $20 towards the kids' new school uniforms." Sir Bernard has now fallen foul of various police forces, including the Turkish, twice, the Thai, twice, the Australian, once, and now the Panamanians, all in the name of charity, if you catch my double-edged drift. Waving to our newfound and slightly richer friend, we set off again, discussing how Bernard prefers this rather than the silly system in England, where marginal infractions can lead to 3 points on a licence. When these rack up, they remove the offending item from you. It starts to rain on entering David, leading us to take shelter under trees, to wait for the torrent to pass, with the gauge showing 30-plus degrees. It's too hot to climb into boil-in-the-bag waterproofs, and so we merely wait it out. Eventually, pushing on to Concepcion, a small hotel appears where, just as we arrive, the heavens open and turn the roads into rivers. Pyrotechnic patterns are traced in the sky as water noisily cascades down roofs, trees and everything else as we unfold our umbrella to splash our way to the cafe, where we consume enormous mountainous meals, wines, beer and coffee, for the price of 1 gallon of petrol in England. All the time, the rain beats a staccato pounding rhythm on the roof, causing raised voices as water rushes down in gushing streams outside the windows, with loud whooshing sounds. It rains like this for 4 hours, while we sit, watch, talk and listen. All the beautiful green landscapes now make sense, as the waitress explains it will rain like this for 3 to 4 hours, and then stop, like a tap turned off. 1 minute, buckets of water falling from the sky, and the next, nothing. Walking back up to our room, it's rained so heavily that a family of large frogs have taken shelter on our porch. They hop out of our way as we cautiously navigate our way past them, while they wait for the torrent to stop sweeping down the path. Bernard offers to retrieve one of them for me, as he swears they're as big as his foot, but I thank him for his kind offer before declining. I can imagine them talking to each other while staring up disconsolately at the sky. "God, it's lashing down," the wife comments in a northern Panamanian accent. "Aye, lass," her dutiful husband responds. "Not fit to be out in," she goes on, hoping for a conversation with her snoozing partner. "Aye, lass," he mumbles from beneath heavy eyelids. "Is that all you're going to say?" she prompts. "Aye, lass." Her eyes scan the horizon as she wonders where it all went wrong. Perhaps. Falling asleep with heavy eyes, I can hear them talking to each other outside our door. And the last thing I heard was, "Aye, lass." At least, that's what it sounded like to me. The morning brings the border between Panama and Costa Rica and the discovery of a missing vital Panamanian document for Bertha to be allowed out of the country. Various people make that dreaded sucking in air noise, which represents an insurmountable problem as huge gales of air are displaced due to this missing piece of paper. We vaguely recall something about a post office when being chauffeured around the cargo compound, but cannot quite pin it down. Meanwhile, there's much huffing and puffing about its lack until eventually $2 magically makes the problem go away. Thus, the dilemma is solved, everybody is happy, and the gales of sucking noises disappear like the Panamanian rain. Instantly. On the Costa Rica side, 3 hours of paper shuffling begins, involving photocopies and even more photocopies of documents. They even throw in the obligatory charge for soaking the bike in disinfectant, in an attempt to bring death and destruction to our recently acquired insectoid, much splattered and already dead, companions. Standing in a puddle of sweat, with my white stick not working its customary magic, queues of people move forward wearing shorts and t-shirts, fanning themselves constantly with handfuls of paper, while we slowly dissolve inside our bike gear. Shuffling forward, leaving a soggy trail, it takes 25 minutes to reach the first window, where a credit card proves you're solvent and have enough money, or debt, to be allowed to enter the country. "Ah, American Express, that'll do nicely." Thump goes the stamp. Part one, done. A sheaf of Spanish forms appear under the opening. It's obvious several more photocopies are needed, as I walk, while Bernard stamps, back to the photocopy office again. 20 minutes later, and several kilograms lighter with the heat, we take station back at the window, with Bernard still muttering. I point out he should try being a Costa Rican getting into England, of their probable need of a letter from a divine authority to get in. He relents and agrees I'm right. The forms go under the glass panel before coming back at us again for even more information. Backwards and forwards they go, like a perpetual game of ping-pong, until the young woman is nearly happy. This we know to be true when she starts entering data, as a dot matrix printer clatters with the sound of 20-year-old machinery. 3 officers later, the very nice customs officer proclaims herself satisfied with the bike, without even looking at it. Definitely not Colombian trained, we guess. Outside in the sun, we cross the road to a cafe, and a waitress asks, "Donde?" Where are you from and going? She looks wistful at the answers, and Bernard says her face is full of longing and regret, as she perhaps dreams of such a journey while serving tables in the dust bowl of the border. Leaving her behind with thoughts of other lives, other possibilities, we manage a whole 300 yards before being waved down at a checkpoint. Off we climb to retrieve all the papers from the pannier before they're minutely examined. After seeing so little of the police, we trundle through police checkpoints every few miles on our way from the border, but happily, they mainly just wave us through. The roads are a patchwork of tarmac, gravel, sand and soil, as we bash our way across surfaces like true professionals. Coming to a junction, we discuss dropping off the Pan American, as it seems to go a long way round. In front of us, there are serious heights, and after so much experience, we know streams of wagons will be dragging themselves up them like inebriated, broken-legged insects. Bernard laughs as he asks me which route to take, after explaining what he sees. To me, the 34 felt right rather than the Pan Am. Here I am in Costa Rica, taking directions from a blind woman about which road to take. His laughter comes through my helmet speakers as he turns off the Pan American to head down the 34 with the blind navigator as a new first. Next stop, professional rallies, shouting, "Left, 60. Miraculously, the road is far, far better than the main highway, and it soon becomes obvious why. The coastal area is full of newly built tourist destinations, hotels and houses built where the Pacific Ocean crashes onto the coast of riches, Costa Rica, so named after the fertility the red soil represented to the Spanish when they first arrived. Interestingly, it's also one of the few countries in the world, one of only 14, that no longer has any form of military or standing army. The army was abolished a few years after World War II, after suffering a brutal 44-day civil war. It was at that time some bright spark, probably sitting at the back of the government class, whispered to the president how, perhaps, all the money could probably be better spent on education and universal health care for its people. Now there's a novel thought. Hours later, we rejoin the Pan Am and begin the climb into the cloud forest, where mist, drizzle and the occasional deluge brings cold and wet for hours on end. The road through the cloud twists and turns so much, is so narrow, that not even a cigarette stop is called for, as it's too dangerous to pull over. Trudging miserably through the cold and wet, we know people come from all over the world to see the forest, but Bernard tells me there's little to see in the big scale of things. Unless, of course, you have a liking for grey cloud and sheet rain. To pass the time, he amuses me with his observations that people are probably rushing through the forest at that very moment, clutching butterfly nets, as we splash past, going, "Please God, let this end soon. Give us both the warmth any time. We've not been this cold since Erzurum or in Peru at 15,000 feet with a closed road. Not since the M5 in England closed in 2007 due to the Great Flood have we felt this wet. At that time, sleeping on a roundabout wrapped up in survival bags, England had become one big lake." Eventually, dropping down into Cartago. The lower altitude leaves the cloud forest, rain and cold behind, as we potter into the outskirts of the town and the El Guarco hotel appears. Gratefully, we climb off the bike after 10 hours with an average speed of 30 kilometres per hour. The next morning, Bernard is tired, responding like the proverbial grumpy old man, and his mood is not helped 25 miles later when I quietly tell him that my white stick is back at the hotel. We pull over, and after several seconds of silence, travel 25 miles back to find it behind the front door of our room, where it had been left for the night. 25 miles later finds us back at the same point, but this time Bernard finds the right road instead of repeating the tour of San Jose taken earlier. Sometimes things just happen for a reason, as I try to convince him. Leaving my stick was a preordained event to save him from getting lost. He's not impressed. Catching up with a large group of motorcycles following a mural-covered pickup truck, they shatter the silence with their open-bore exhausts and handlebars that reach upwards to the sky, like the bike that Henry Fonda rode in Easy Rider. Harley-Davidsons predominate, with chrome glistening in the sunshine, along with cut-off denim jackets covered in badges and chapter colours. Carving our way through the Hell's Angels cavalcade, Bernard picks them off a few at a time, until we leave them behind at their sedate 50 miles per hour. Perhaps they're out to cause terror and mayhem in the Costa Rican countryside, although, by all the friendly waves, horn-blowing, flashing headlights and big thumbs up coming at us, they could simply be out for a ride and a cup of tea. Eventually returning home, they'll probably climb into business suits, pick up briefcases, kiss their wives and children goodbye before taking the train to work. Who knows? What you see depends on what you look for. The roads narrow into single lanes as trees close in on both sides, while overhead a canopy forms, bringing welcome shade and coolness after the heat as we blast along towards the Nicaraguan border. Black tarmac stretches in front of us, and good surfaces abound, with another large group of motorcycles soon appearing in our mirrors. They pass us in ones and twos, mixtures of street machines and semi-chopped bikes, all chrome and polish, making us look like two tramps in comparison. They dip and dive past the Sunday drivers in the hills, and soon we tuck in behind them. Bertha is soon diving into corners, up and down gears, passing everything as we hurtle into the distance. Bernard's brain pulses and becomes infused with adrenaline and testosterone as I begin to wonder if we've stumbled accidentally onto the starting grid of a Grand Prix race. After several miles of roaring down leafy lanes with Bertha about to explode every gasket, my errant friend's blood pressure returns to normal. His brain stops pulsing, and satisfaction is pronounced. On a nearly 20-year-old heavily laden bike, as I point out to him at the resulting lunch break. Within seconds, surrounded by people from the cafe, 15-year-old Ian translates backwards and forwards, and we become firm friends. Seconds after Bernard tells him Ian is an English name. Leaving our young friend to dream of road trips and large motorcycles, we ride on to the border a few miles later, where hordes of helpers appear. By the nature of their insistent voices, it seems we'll be stuck here for at least a week without their help. Sadly, they forgot to tell the very nice, fully gold-toothed customs officer who stamped and signed everything off without a Colombian strip search of either Bertha or ourselves. Slowly crossing the border into Nicaragua, time reverses as decades turn back, with a road that suddenly stops being replaced by gravel and hardcore. shoddiness radiates all around in the dirty, once white, grey buildings, as Costa helpers are replaced by their Nicaraguan brothers, who proclaim it's harder to get into Nicaragua than for an Afghan refugee to get into England. Handing over $3, Bertha is again drowned in disinfectant, and so is everything we possess, as a very nice certificate is passed to us from a very bored-looking young lady in a booth. Meanwhile, word has gone round of the two naive gringos arriving, as helpers dive into every bush, looking for Rudolph, as, after all, he must be somewhere, as Santa has arrived. Having seen this so many times before, we're better prepared, as a horde of them trail our every move. We must look like Pied Pipers, or in the heat, Fried Pipers, with so many following us, until we quite take to one of them and accept his offer after first checking the price. Anardo is about 40 years old and speaks English very well, and gently leads us from pillar to post, from office to window. Health check forms are duly signed, declaring that no, we do not have sore throats, coughs, colds, or any other rabid-like or death-dealing symptom of the pandemic flu. Bernard indicates the only sore throat experienced is from talking. Actually, he indicates me, much to the amusement of the staff, sitting behind their white face masks. Anardo then leads us past lines of American bus tourists visiting Nicaragua openly, unlike some of their military in the past. Handing over more dollars for the cost of passport stamps, bike insurance, and a stamp from a customs officer, we wonder how much he pays for having his shoes shined by the barefooted boy kneeling in the dust. Nearby, American tourists are busily snapping away at Bertha, while proclaiming, "Oh my God, you've come all the way from England?" just as the heavens open. The sudden deluge turns the dust into white mud as we stand under the porch of the health check area, sheltering from the sudden onslaught. Soon, all the local wise boys join us, appearing from bushes and buildings, looking for the free money represented by our presence as we move from porch to tree and tree to porch as they follow us. It seems Nicaragua abounds with free money from Santa, who now rides a large red motorcycle. Being English, Bernard merely snorts when they demand $1 for their help, when they'd earlier pointed towards the Passaporte building. Becoming more insistent as Bernard's snorts get louder and louder, eventually they give up. After guzzling several cold drinks and packing half a tree of Nicaraguan paperwork into the panniers, we set off, only to be pulled over within 5 heartbeats for a document check. Perhaps it was 10 beats, but the outcome is the same. Off we climb, unlocking panniers before retrieving everything. Personally, we both think they just want to look at the bike, as most of the documents are in English anyway. With Bernard resolutely practicing his Spangolese, it's obvious English is not their 5th, never mind 2nd language, but they're happy with everything. Who are we to deny officials their bit of excitement, enlivening up the boredom of watching the dust blowing all day? Heading for Rivas, 30 or so kilometres away, we pull into a lake resort, nestling under the shadows of a massive, thankfully dormant, volcano, with everything covered under a blue haze of heat. The armed guards on the gate carry the weapon of preference, pump-action shotguns, but they happily wave us through to bounce down the pitted entrance road. The resort seems empty, with the only visible sign of life being on the floor of the reception area, which is a midge graveyard, as the bored receptionist shows us to a $70 room. Every step taken is met with the sounds of Bernard blowing loudly to save ingesting the clouds of midges turning up to welcome us. Despite questioning if the $70 was a mistranslation of $7, the receptionist does not take the hint. Since we've left our jungle nets at home, we won't need them. Along with our thermostatically controlled survival suits, her offer of accommodation is declined, as neither of us fancy being a meal for the black cloud which follows us constantly. Further down the road, Rivas itself soon appears, a town where poverty shouts from all around as people stare at our passing. The level of destitution makes Bernard nervous just riding through it, as many men sit around sharpening long machetes. Standing on street corners, with the light glinting off the razor sharpness of their jungle cleavers, darkness is beckoning, and we need to get off the road. But it's another 40 miles before arriving at a blacked-out, power-poor Jinotepe guest house. Two parrots declare control of their kingdom to all and sundry in the cafe next door, as they freely wander around the floor while we sit in the midge-free dark, munching on rice, pancakes and other things only vaguely recognisable. Bernard recognises the beer, happily quaffing several cans of Heineken, would you believe, while noting with some justification, "Well, it's been really, really hot today. It'll help me sleep properly." Funnily enough, sleep never seems to be one of the things he has any problems with. A young boy sneaks up behind as we eat, being careful to keep out of the sight of staff. Asking for free gringo money, for my hunger. He sits on the floor and repeats the same thing over and over until one of our plates of untouched food is offered. Suddenly, his hunger seems cured. It's true that, compared to many unfortunate people, we are indeed Father Christmas, the Tooth Fairy, and the leprechaun at the end of the rainbow with a pot of gold, all rolled into one. Represented by the shiny red metallic parcel Bertha represents to many people. It's also true, it's hard to say no when you're sitting up close and personal with need in this way. While this is true, before even leaving England, Bernard had told me this is the way it has to be. Once you start giving, there's no end. In some countries, every day is the same, with the level of need only changing by the face before you. You also have to wonder what distinguishes one person's poverty from another. It's true you can talk about poverty in terms of absolute and relative to the end of the world, but it can never help you when a 10-year-old boy sits 2 feet away, chanting, "Dollar for my hunger," constantly. Is poverty worse among the 1 billion people in India? Is it worse in a Nicaragua ravaged by decades of conflict, leaving a country with few natural resources, but many shiny machetes? Why give to one person and not another? How do you decide? Eventually, the young boy wanders off, looking back reproachfully, leaving the plate of food untouched. The morning brings a 6:30 a.m. exit, when we find breakfast is as scarce as free equipment from transglobal bike manufacturers. We ride round and round in the capital, Managua, until dizzy and sweating profusely. Hopelessly lost in the dust and potholes of the city, Bertha trundles through shantytowns of cardboard and black plastic, covering the sides of the road in the same way as in India. It's a world away in distance and time, but not in appearance or sentiment. People sit amid the squalor, with empty eyes staring ahead. Lost in thought, they focus on the sound of Bertha before locating us, and then a brightness enters their eyes for a few seconds. They smile. Then we're gone. It leaves Bernard wondering if they return back to the same vacant look prior to our passing. Without a map or working sat-nav system, Bernard uses the compass to find our way forward. Eventually working our way through the rubbish-strewn streets, We climb out of the obstacle course our route has taken us through. Stopping for petrol when we do find the CA1. $3 per gallon is handed over for fuel. In a country where people earn $1 a day, in an economy grinding along in desperation.